Hey everyone, it's Pastor Josh again with our daily Bible Insight video. If you've been reading your Bible, hopefully you have your Bible reading plan we handed out. You would have read Genesis 24 and 25 today. I hope you have. I'm going to touch on those today for a few moments and hopefully not take too much of your time. Also, just want to say that the Bible reading plan is not by way of legalism or to force you to do something. If you've already got a plan and you're reading your scriptures daily, I think that's wonderful. I think you just need to continue to do that. This is just kind of an aid to help those that maybe struggle with reading or maintain daily consistency and that sort of thing with the Lord. So real quick, let's get into it. Quite a bit to cover, but again, just Genesis 24 and 25. So what can we say about Genesis 24 and 25? Well, Genesis 24 is all about, again, God's providence and provision and providing. Right? And in this case, he provides the bride for Isaac. We talked about in Genesis 23, the end of it was Abraham being told about his brother Nahor and her wife who born children to him, listing out all the names, and we hear that Rebekah is listed as one of them, right? Well, the servant that Abraham causes to make an oath to the Lord to go get a bride for Isaac from his people, not in the Canaanite land, right? We don't want to intermarry with the Canaanites is basically what Abraham's saying. He sends Eliezer. He's the oldest of his household. If you remember back a few chapters ago, can't remember which one exactly, when God promised Abraham a son, he said, Lord, that he blessed him. He said, Lord, what will you give me? I have no child, and Eliezer will be the heir. And God says, no, it won't be. But anyway, so Eliezer is the one that Abraham sends off to go find him a wife for Isaac. Obviously, Abraham's getting near his end. And he knows that the Lord promised to his descendants that he would give them the land in which he is dwelling right now. And that's the Canaanite land with all the other ites. And so Abraham knew that he was not to take a wife from the Canaanites there. So Eliezer goes with the camels, and if you read, you know the story, so I'm not going to get into that. I'm just going to touch on some highlights here. Laban was Rebekah's brother, and we should take particular notice of his response in verse 55, right? So the servant comes, he first meets Rebekah after praying. God answers the prayer. Rebekah does what, you know, he was hoping. They go to her house. He puts the ring on her and the bracelets, and then explains everything to Laban, her brother, and Bethuel, her father, about what he prayed, or first what Abraham swore him to, then what he prayed, then what Rebekah did, and all that. And so here in verse 55, though, Laban says, let the girl stay with us a few days, say 10. Afterward, she may go. Now, if you or I went to someone, as was the custom of the day, and gave them all kinds of goodies, right? Fine goods, gold, silver, and various other things. But then they told you, thanks for all that stuff. Thanks, you know, we're glad that the Lord answered your prayer, but we're going to think about it for a little longer, maybe 10 days or so. You'd probably be like, I don't think so, no. And then consider, if you back up just 5 verses to verse 50, both Laban, Rebekah's brother, and Bethuel, her father, said, quote, the matter comes from the Lord, so we cannot speak to you, good or bad. Here is Rebekah before you. Take her and go. Right? And then later on, it's, let us think about it. This kind of tells you, if you've been paying attention, what type of person Laban is, or perhaps maybe what type of family he comes from, or maybe he was considering some ulterior motives. Of course, we don't want to be speculative or make erroneous assumptions without support, but as you continue your reading, you'll notice that deceit runs deep in the family, as it does favoritism, doesn't it? The text says Isaac loved Esau, the text says that Isaac loved Esau and Rebekah loved Jacob, right? Favoritism, right? Later in chapter 27, you see that Rebekah encourages Jacob to be deceitful to his own father, right? So there's a lot of that going on. And then again, later on, when Jacob is seeking a wife, we see that Laban, his mother's brother, is very deceitful to him, right? So there's a lot of that going on. Just something to take note of so you can kind of piece things together. Anyway, that's Genesis 24. What can we say about Genesis 25? Well, we see in this chapter that God, again, is coming through in his promise to bless and enlarge Ishmael, right? He made that promise to Hagar, to Abraham. And thus we see this through the descendants of Ishmael listed out, right? It says 12 princes came from him. And so God made that promise. God fulfilled that promise because God is what we consider immutable. He doesn't change in his being. That is, his existence is always the same. His purposes, his promises. And so we always want to make sure that every time we see a promise that God's going to bring it about because that's his will. So at any rate, you see that there. And then notice something else, though. Rebekah, like Sarah, was barren. She could not conceive, right? And so what does Isaac do? In verse 21, it says Isaac prayed for his wife and the Lord answered him. Then Rebekah, when she did conceive, she was experiencing some struggles within her womb, right? And she's questioning what's going on. Well, what does she do? She inquired of the Lord, and he explains to her that the supernatural ordination of events that would come from her, right? The two children, there's two nations in there striving. And God said the older would serve the younger. God decreed these events before they ever even took place. Isn't that amazing to know that God is in control? I mean, it's just a wonderful picture of his sovereignty, and we should take peace in that, knowing that no matter what, God is in control and working all things for his glory in his will. And that's the important part. Not our glory, not our will. I always say the world doesn't revolve around us. It revolves around the sun, right? S-U-N and S-O-N, Jesus Christ. And so it's just a wonderful thing to see in Scripture when God causes something to come to fruition that he promised long ago. And if you remember back to Genesis 3:15, what did God tell Eve? That I will put enmity, he was talking to the serpent, I will put enmity between your seed, the serpent's seed, and his seed, or her seed, right? And he's talking about that that her seed will crush your head, but you will bruise his heel, excuse me. Yeah. That was the first picture of the gospel, the promise that Jesus Christ would come, that someone from the seed from the woman would come to destroy the serpent, right? And that's what we're looking forward to as we progress through Scripture, is who is this one, right? And then we have to take into account all the other things going on. And so it's just wonderful to see God's sovereignty time and time again in Scripture and how everything works together for good for those who are called according to his purpose and love God. And so the last thing I want us to look at is how Esau despised his birthright. This was a pretty big deal back then. And if you were the first in line, you received the blessing, the majority of the inheritance, and the leadership of the family when the father passed, right? And Esau considered this to have no significance in his life because he sold it for a bowl of red stew. Now, as you read later on in Scripture, you'll see that the Edomites, the nation of Edom, come from or descend from Esau, right? And then it says there after he was speaking with Jacob about the stew that thus he was called Edom. Esau was called Edom. Why? Well, Edom means red, and Esau sold his birthright for a bowl of red stew. It's kind of a play on words there to show how badly he despised his birthright. And you'll actually see later on in the Scripture that God destroys Edom, the nation of Edom, because they constantly persecute and rise against the descendants of Jacob, the tribes of Israel. We'll see that later on. But anyway, so yes, he sells his birthright. Don't miss even though he did that, don't miss the deceitfulness of Jacob here, okay? You know, oh, you're famished and on the verge of death and you want something to eat? I did make this big pot of stew, but sell me your birthright and I'll give you some, right? So again, even through sinful motives, we can see how God is working according to his will, right? Because the older will serve the younger, right? So that means that Jacob will be the one that comes out with the blessing and the leadership and all those things, even though Jacob went about it in a deceitful manner. And even though Rebekah, God made that promise to Rebekah, we see later on that she goes about it in a deceitful manner as well. So anyway, what I want us to notice also in chapter 25 is how Isaac and Rebekah both responded when they had concerns, when they had problems or questions. What did they do? Well, if you read the text, you know that they sought the Lord. Both of them immediately sought the Lord. Do you do that? Gosh, I hope so. I hope so. It's so important. Well, anyway, I'm going to sum up here because I'm already past my minute marker. Just hope you will continue reading the Scriptures. If you have any questions, there's a link in the description that will help you or take you to our website where you can submit a question, and we'll be happy to help you with any further understanding or clarification on anything you're reading. It doesn't have to just be the reading plan. It could be whatever you're reading in the Bible. You have a question or concern, we'd be happy to assist you with that. Over here, you'll see our subscription to our channel. Please do that. Over here, you will see the playlist for the Bible Insight videos. Appreciate you watching. Let us know in the comments if these are helping out or if there's anything else we can address for you. All right, until next time, God bless you.